I'm Paul. This video is mainly for piano students, and I'd like to talk to you about hand injuries and cramping, as this subject comes up in comments, and I'd like to suggest a solution. The most common type of practice pain is ligament inflammation, usually on the top middle part of the hand. It comes as a result of practicing repetitively for longer than your fingers feel comfortable with. If you ignore that twinge of soreness at the onset and keep practicing, you might find the pain increases to the point you can't move your fingers at all and have no choice but to stop practicing and leave the piano alone for days or even weeks so that your hand repairs itself. This can seem a long and frustrating wait, especially if you're used to playing the piano every day. Pain or cramping can be the result of practice with uneven articulation in fingers 3, 4 and 5. Most serious piano students experience some kind of mild hand injury at least once in their early days, and if and when it happens, they seldom forget it. This unpleasant experience often motivates them to better understand the cause and to find a solution. If you love practicing demanding piano music, there's no quick way to avoid hand injury or cramping, but there is a slow way, which I hope you'll find reassuring, as everyone can master it to some degree for all levels of playing experience. This slow way comes to us from Chopin, the composer many pianists consider wrote the greatest music for the piano. Chopin's understanding of piano technique was second to none. His articulation building method is based on the practice of an ordinary chromatic scale, just with weaker fingers 3, 4, 5 alone, rather than the naturally stronger fingers 1, 2, 3 we are most used to. The chromatic scale exercise helps even out and strengthen the articulation right across the hand better than anything else. In my view, Chopin's Etude, Opus 10, number 2, is the best technical study for the right hand ever written. I have a tutorial on 10.2 with a number of free chromatic scale exercises in progressive levels of difficulty designed for the relative beginner right through to the advanced student. The earlier you start the chromatic scale with fingers 3, 4, 5, the better off you'll be later on. Practicing major and minor scales across 4 octaves is, of course, technically helpful, but these type of scales by themselves don't build articulation in the weaker fingers anywhere near as well as 10.2. I know most of you are familiar with Chopin's Etude, so we'll have noticed that major and minor scales hardly figure in any of them. When scales do appear, they tend to be chromatic, such as the double third scales in 25.6, which, as an etude, is very close in spirit to 10.2, as the chromatic double third scale uses fingers 3, 4, 5 on the upper note. The technical essence of 25.10 in octaves is again similar to 10.2, as legato octave fingering has fingers 3, 4, 5 passing the octaves along one to the next on the upper note. In concert and commercial recordings, 10.2 tends to be played around Chopin's indicated tempo of 144 BPM. And in recent years, there's a growing trend, especially for major piano competitions, to push the tempo somewhat faster. My concern is that most progressing piano students will find even 144 BPM far too fast for them and way out of reach. So, with this in mind, I'd like to encourage students instead to aim to play 10.2 at a much slower tempo, around 100 or 110, which I call the student tempo. This slower tempo can still feel every bit as musical and gives the student the opportunity to concentrate on musical things far more important than speed. Even at a slower tempo, 10.2 is still extremely demanding. For example, controlling crescendo and diminuendo with the touch and attack of fingers 3, 4, 5 is an extremely important part of the study, best achieved by practicing at a slower tempo. When the chromatic scale changes direction at the top or the bottom, the fingers can involuntarily speed up, cramp up, or lag behind. So there's a lot of detailed finger legato to consider, best perfected at a slower tempo. Sometimes progressing piano students are curious at comparing Chopin's etudes in terms of levels of difficulty. From my own experience, all the etudes are extremely difficult. That said, the etudes that sound the hardest to the listener aren't actually the hardest to play. For example, Winter Wind is easier to play at a fast tempo than to get simple sounding 10-2, even up to a clear and confident 110. Take the ever popular Revolutionary. Sounds so difficult and dramatic to the listener, but it's somewhat easier and involves far less practice for a piano student to get up to the traditional performance tempo than to play 10-2 at even half of its indicated performance tempo. So in my experience, 10-2 is by far the hardest of Chopin's etudes, but it's the etude that best deserves your attention. Now, I'll run through 10-2 at around 110, which I call the student tempo. As mentioned, I have a series of tutorials on Chopin's 10-2 in progressive levels of difficulty. There's a chromatic exercise to suit every level and any age. The sheet music exercises are all free to download from links in the video description. I hope you found this video useful. Good luck with your practice, and thanks for watching.